we had a choice. Either you're going to stand up for Manitobans in a year when the feds come in, as they've threatened to do with a higher carbon tax, or you do it now, and we're doing it now.
Manitoba Premier Brian Pallister announced about an hour ago that his province is dropping out of its own carbon pricing plan. Welcome back to Power and Politics and the Power Panel, Supriya Devetti, Tim Powers, Kathleen Monk, and Chris Hall. Manitoba had proposed a plan to the federal government, but it did not increase to the levels in future years that the feds had set as a minimum bar to meet. Supriya, I'll start with you. It seems like a domino effect now. This is another province saying we're not buying into this.
So I think we need to separate two things, the legality and the actual jurisdictional validity that the federal government has, and the political optics of conservative and in some cases liberal-leaning premiers to want to opt out of this. I think ultimately, the consensus amongst the legal community is that, yes, the federal government does have the jurisdictional validity to go forward with a carbon tax. Does any government really want to do that if a big chunk of the provinces are kicking and screaming and it looks like you're just rounding up a bunch of petulant toddlers? Probably not. But that doesn't change the legal fact of it all. From the political side of things, what's interesting here is that we were all sort of, just to pull the curtain back a little bit, during the break, we were all sort of discussing what the release actually meant. And in it, it specifies that they're not going to put a carbon tax, but does that mean that they could technically go along with Quebec and California and take Ontario's place in a cap and trade and do a more market-based solution, because that is amongst, you know, generally ideological conservative thinkers, the more preferred route. It's unclear to me why anyone in this day and age would want to do nothing, absolutely, when it comes to climate change, especially when, as a country, we've seen wildfires in BC, we've seen wildfires in Ontario, you've seen a record number of deaths in a heat wave in Quebec. People know that climate change is happening. We know we need to put a price on pollution, and we need to do something about it. The question is, who is going to be willing to be an adult in the room and say, yeah, okay, we have to do something about this?
Supriya just answered her own question. Technically and politically speaking, there will be a price on carbon. It just won't be from Manitoba's government or Ontario's government or Saskatchewan's government. It'll be from the federal government, and that's the calculation that's being made here. There will be a price on carbon. Whether it's even close to being high enough to actually make a difference in meeting the 2022 targets, the Paris Accord targets that we've agreed to, is an open question right now. But politically, the blame and the responsibility will rest with the federal Liberals.
Yes. Politically, what we're seeing now is we've seen Saskatchewan, Ontario, we've seen Alberta as a result of the TMX. We know that New Brunswick, depending on what happens there. All of them are pulling out. So politically, Catherine McKenna is not looking like she's done a good job selling this. So how does she
now get... it's Dominic LeBlanc's job.
Well, Dominic LeBlanc, exactly. So how do they get around that? Well, politically, that's why McKenna has actually floated the idea of the Canadian government, the federal government, rebating people directly, right? Yeah. So implement it federally, and then we'll get to cut the check. And whoever cuts that check to Canadians, people generally like getting a check.
People remember that.
They remember that. But this is in contrast to a lot of steam being raised by these right-wing provincial parties, including this big scrap the carbon tax rally, which is happening this Friday between Premier Doug Ford and UCP leader Jason Kenney in Alberta. That's happening this Friday on the eve of Thanksgiving, in Calgary, and they're going to rally against this carbon tax. So it is really setting up a real war with the feds.
You know, I'm reminded of that great Queen song, Bashy, Another One Bites the Dust, and another one's gone, and another one bites the dust. This is what's happening to the Prime Minister.
Though
I'm not sure it's as bad as we all... Yeah, sorry, Freddie Mercury was never that terrible. I'm not sure it's as bad for the federal government politically as it could be, because it does set up for the Prime Minister. It's bad from a policy perspective, as they seem to want to be committed to this, but from a political perspective, they're setting themselves up up for a very nice battle of contrasts. And I think they probably think they have enough pockets of different voters in different jurisdictions who will align with their message of standing up for the future and what is right. And because the premiers they will be battling against will be very powerful personalities that are the antithesis of Justin Trudeau, that isn't necessarily terrible for them. What it means for a policy, though, is that it is significantly challenged politically. It could be a benefit for them to have these fights.
I think, Supriya, it was so interesting that I guess the premier has said that he's leaving the door open to joining the legal challenge against the federal case, which you sort of remarked about on the top of your answer. But he had, when I had the premier on a long time ago, he was saying, no, we're going to do a price on carbon or a carbon tax because we sought a legal opinion and it was that we wouldn't win. So he, at that point, he thought, you know, and clearly the calculation has changed, whether from a legal perspective or a political one since then.
Yeah, I would imagine that the calculation has changed not from a legal perspective, because I can't imagine what has changed in that short period of time. It's not like there's been a mountain of precedent that would, end up going towards the province's side on this sort of thing. But I think politically, because you do have, Jason Kenney in Alberta, as well as the actual premier in Alberta pulling out of this, and you have, Doug Ford here in Ontario, and Kathleen numbered
Scott
off.
Scott Moe. Yeah, Scott Moe.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Saskatchewan.
Exactly. So, like, there's a bunch, right? So there is strength in numbers. And to Tim's point, another one bites the dust. If you've got this sort of domino effect and you make it look like it's a bunch of the provinces challenging the big, bad federal government, I mean, to your own people, that's never really a bad optics look for you if you're standing up for your own mandate and for your own people against what you're going to portray as a bully and shoving this down your throat.
The Liberals federally have been consistent about this. You have to give them that. They haven't changed their view. If you don't do it, we're going to do it. What I was struck by is that it has to be their plan and no other plan will do, even though there's doubts about whether any plan is actually going to be sufficient. In the case of Manitoba, they were going to charge more in the first 2 years, but not as much in the last four.
They had a different way of,
Right, and that was deemed unacceptable.
That's what Pallister said today.
Right, I think the question ultimately for the Liberal government will be, so what is the actual substantive difference between those two? Not in the amount of money, but in terms of meeting those targets you committed to in Paris and making a real difference in reducing the amount of greenhouse gas emissions.
And it's interesting because they had been so hardline on it for so long. And then recently when we had LeBlanc on, I know you have too, he seemed to say, well, we're willing to work with provinces, and it didn't seem to be as black and white. But come January, we're still imposing it if you don't meet it. So clearly the message had been sent.
But they could go cap and trade if they wanted to, right? And I mean, this is the thing, is that Chris does have a point. But for example, Quebec isn't being thrown under this lot, and Ontario wasn't until there was a change in government, because there is cap and trade as that other option that for whatever reason...
you can do A or B.
Yeah.
But the real question here is, so how is Andrew Scheer going to try and capitalize on this? He has a plan. We'll hear the plan eventually. But what one is he going to follow? Because in certain jurisdictions, being hard against the carbon tax will get him votes, as he describes it. But pan-Canada, and he needs to win seats across Canada, having that hard line isn't necessarily going to work for him. So he's got to figure this out. It creates a bit of an opportunity, but it's one that's got to be deftly managed.
And if I could just jump in, it's like right now for the Conservatives, it seems there's a plethora of issues they're trying to wedge the Liberals on. Mm-hmm. Immigration, crime we've seen in recent days, and of course now there's the climate change file and the carbon tax file. And a very wise colleague of mine said tonight, he remarked, this is going to be a replay of 2008 and the green, we all remember Stéphane Dion's, green plan or
priorities.
green shift.
Are difficult.
And they're going to try to potentially wedge them on that. So leading into the election, it's dangerous if they don't get this solved.
Supriya, quick final word to you.
Yeah, I would just say that the one thing also Mr. Scheer has to be careful is in areas that have a large, South Asian population, new Canadians, so to say, if they're in touch with what's happening in the home country or the old country, weather hasn't been too good in India in the last 6 months. They've suffered droughts, they've suffered floods, they've suffered massive heat waves. So that also trickles down. So you have to be careful, again, with just playing the whole tax card when increasingly people are understanding that climate change is a real thing and it's here.